Hey everybody, and welcome to day two of our 5-day violin practice marathon. I'm so excited to be here today again with all of you. And yes, in this marathon, I'm sharing one secret practice hack to become a violin superhuman every day. And today I'm going to share a hack that I'm specifically really passionate about because it actually, I didn't do this and it made me so unmotivated to practice, and I didn't practice for a few years because I didn't implement this hack. So I'm so passionate to talk with you about this specific thing today. But first, I'm going to check who's joining us today. So write in the chat your name and the country where you're joining us from, because I always love to see where everybody is coming from that is joining these live lessons. I see Maria is joining us today, Rick, Treta Amarnath is joining us today. Sergio, I see many people that have joined yesterday. I want to give a special shout out to everybody who has joined the class yesterday. That is a sign of true motivation that you came again today. So I'm so proud of all of you to come again to practice. So I see Bob is joining us, and Perira, and Ineke, Angelina, Josie, and people from all over the world, Egypt, Scotland, UK, Iraq. By the way, everybody, do you like our new beautiful classroom page? The page where you are now on, we have been working on it this afternoon to make it look even more beautiful. And so you don't get distracted by other YouTube videos when watching the live class. So I hope you like it, everybody. And I see, meanwhile, I see Sergio joining, Marianne, Nancy, Manu, and Ekane, Tia. Wow, nice. Also some new faces that I didn't see before. So Kanaf, Chai, Tanya. Wow, the names are so difficult for me as a Dutch person to pronounce them. So it's not personal if I pronounced your name in the wrong way. So yeah, so excited for everybody to be here today. You are definitely in the right place today. If you ever felt demotivated or frustrated or bored when you were practicing. So if you've ever felt one of these three emotions when practicing, this is especially the right class for you, because it is especially about these feelings and yeah, where they are actually coming from and how to solve it. So yeah, stay tuned for that. And by the way, for those who stay all the way to the end of the class, so if you stay all the way until the end, I have a special surprise for you. So that is a little gift for everybody that is staying until the last bit of the class to motivate you to come and stay. So definitely stay until the end for the special gift for the most motivated students of the day. So yeah, let's get started. So maybe I have to start with the story of how I didn't do this hack and how I got stuck. So when I started playing the violin, my violin is here, by the way, and I didn't start on this violin. I started on a smaller violin. I think I was 10 years old when I really started to take it serious, violin playing. And that's when I got a teacher and really started to practice a lot. And first, when I just started, I was really, really motivated to practice. I was playing with the Suzuki method. I don't know, or I think many of you do know it. This is the method I was taught with in the beginning, and I was really, really motivated. And my teacher was this really amazing teacher who would give me like stickers if I finished a song. So I was always like, I don't know if I was more motivated to learn the violin or more motivated to get a sticker. Then God will only know. But yeah, I was really, really motivated to practice. And at some point, when I continued, at one point, my teacher said, oh, Julia, you have to continue to another teacher, because I feel like I was getting like quite proficient at that point. And my teacher felt a little bit insecure to teach me, because I had expressed the wish to her that I would want to be a teacher in the future. And she said, she said to me that I would need a better teacher that would teach me even higher up, more difficult things that she was not able to do herself. So I should move to another teacher. And I guess with this teacher, this is the moment that actually my demotivated time came. I felt really, really demotivated to practice. And it felt always like a chore. It didn't feel anymore like, oh, I'm doing this for myself. I'm really, really enjoying this practice. It felt like I have to do it, and I have to do it for my teacher, and I have to do it for myself, because otherwise I will kind of screw up my future. I cannot be a violin teacher in the future. So yeah, I had a lot of pressure, and I didn't really like it anymore. And I didn't really understand why I started to dislike violin playing, because I always loved it, and it was like so genuine, this passion of mine, that I didn't really know what it was coming from. And it was only years after, when I've heard about this principle that I'm going to share in this lesson, that I understood, oh, wait a second, so that is why I was so demotivated. This was the problem that I had during that time. And it really led me up to, at some point, just like doing the bare minimum of 5 minutes practice a day. And then I moved on to playing piano, because that felt so much more fun, because with the piano, I didn't have the same struggles as with violin. But I will get into that later, why that happened. So yeah, so what was the specific secret, or the thing that I've learned that really started to transform my playing again, and actually started to make me realize why I felt this demotivated and what I needed to do to come out of it? And this is the principle that I have actually learned from Fisher. This is like, he is writing really many books about violin teachers, amazing teacher, you can look him up. And he has been talking about the principle of advancing versus improving. And I don't know if anybody of you have heard from that, but this principle says you can practice in two ways. You can practice to advance, and you can practice to improve. And in this lesson, I want you to show the difference between advancing and improving, and how you can tell in which stage you are, if you are advancing or improving actually. And also, if you are in the advancing state, which is the stage you don't want to be in, how you can move to that improving stage. So yeah, first let's talk about what advancing and improving actually is. So the difference between improving and advancing is a way of improvement, but it is not an improvement where you actually get better at violin playing. If you are advancing, you are only learning new pieces, but you are not really getting better as a violin player. And I have been in this advancing stage, and that was why I was so demotivated. So advancing stage can feel really, really frustrating. It feels like you reach a kind of plateau, and almost like you can do anything, you can practice anything, but you won't improve. So no matter what you do, you won't improve. That is how it feels. And that is so frustrating. That is one of the most frustrating feelings you can get if you like to play the violin. And, you know, one of the things that drives us is also to get better, of course. We want to play our favorite pieces, and we want to enjoy it. And on the moment we feel stagnant, that is a really frustrating feeling, especially because we all work really, really hard to practice a lot and to get where we have gotten so far. So it is a really good feeling if you notice that you are actually getting something from all of the effort you are putting in. If you're advancing, you are learning new pieces, but you're not getting better. And if you are improving, you are really not only learning new pieces, but you are fundamentally improving your skills. So that actually, if you are seeing yourself 1 year back and practicing for 1 year, and you are just seeing yourself play, you're like, oh my God, I play so much better right now. This is this really great feeling where you feel like you don't only learn new pieces, but you also learn fundamental technique. I can show you an example of advancing versus improving. For instance, where I really, really improved, when I just started playing the violin, I couldn't sight read at all. I didn't know how to read, and it took me a lot of years actually to learn how to read sheet music. I think I took exceptionally long because I found it really difficult in some way reading notes. And yeah, 5 years after I started playing, I started to notice that I can read notes from just from seeing the sheet music. And that was like such a big, huge revelation, improvement. I don't know how I want to call it, but it really changed my life, because right now I can open a violin book and see a piece that I've never, ever seen before and just play it from the sheet music. I can just directly play most pieces that are in first or third position that are not like all the way like really, really difficult, but I can play most classical pieces, most all like beginner intermediate pieces only from reading sheet music. And that is such a, like, that was such a big improvement. And that was something really, really fun to realize, like, wow, you really improved. So that is what improvement feels like. Improvement feels like, whoa, you can't believe that you've learned so much. And you look back on yourself a few years ago and you're like, wow, you're like impressed with yourself. That's the feeling of improvement. And that is what the feeling that we all want, right? So that is also what I'm going to share a few tips to really get that feeling and to really, yeah, get in that improvement, in like continuously improve yourself and how to go about that. So the feeling of advancement is really, really different. And I am not sure right now, I would love to hear in the comments if anybody can like relate to this feeling of advancement in or improvement, and in which stage you feel you are right now. Are you like improving or are you advancing? What is what you, how do you feel right now about your progress? Let me know in the chat. I'm going to see what all of you say. So if you are improving, you feel really, really good. But if you are advancing, that would be, an example would be that in the time that I was only advancing, I was studying with a teacher here in the Netherlands, and he would give me new pieces every few months. And each time that I started studying a new piece, I didn't completely finish the other piece. So it was always like, each piece that I played, I was like, yeah, it's okay, you know? But none of the pieces I actually played, I felt really like, wow, I got this piece. I nailed it. I can perform it for an audience. It was always like, yeah, I kind of can play this piece, but if I would have to perform it in public, I would feel ashamed. So it didn't really feel like I was really getting the pieces. That is a feeling of advancement. That is when you learn a lot of things, but only half-hearted. You don't really, really learn it to the core. You have learned like it, you've learned it partly. Another feeling of advancing is when maybe you are a folk player and you learn new pieces, learn new folk pieces, and they are all like around the same level. So you feel like you have learned a new piece, but you didn't really like to the core improve your technique, because maybe you can still only play in first position and you don't even dare to go into fifth position, let alone higher position. So that is also a feeling of advancing, where you've learned new tunes but didn't really like learn new techniques that give you confidence. If you are improving, you feel very, very confident. And I'm going to retrace now how you are feeling right now, which phase you are. And then I'm going to give you tips how you can improve. This is going to be really like theoretical in a way, but also very practical in the way that you can apply it directly to your practice session. So right now I'm going to read the comments. And maybe one thing to mention before reading the comments is, it is easier to get into the improving phase if you just started learning the violin. Because if you just started, you can't really advance, because there's nothing that you've ever learned before, right? So you've never ever played the violin. So the only thing you can do is learn something new. So you will always feel like you're learning something new. Whereas if you have been playing for a few years, it is much easier to come in this advancing stage where you feel like you're not improving anymore, because it gets harder to challenge yourself. You can do some things already, and it also requires more energy to actually say, oh, I can play that, but I'm not going to play that. I am going to play something that is way, way more difficult. So probably people that are more like in advanced stages or played for a longer amount of time can relate very much to the advancing stage as well. And the beginner challenge is more like being so overwhelmed with so many things at the same time that you are improving, but you feel like you want to give up because it's just so much that you feel like you're not improving because you can't do anything, right? So that is what you feel like if you are a beginner. So let's see what all of you are saying. So Amaya says, I feel like I'm slightly improving. That's great. And Rick says, advancing a lot. So that is definitely, Rick is a student at Julia's Violin Academy, so I know him personally. And I do know that Rick is playing for a few years already. So it makes complete sense that it will be much easier to get into the trap of just advancing, learning new pieces, but not really fundamentally improving. And Shaitanya says, improving. So that is great. And Elmer says, I have had a little retrograde in the past weeks. It's quite discouraging. I think many of us can relate that it can be really discouraging sometimes to practice. And especially if you feel like no matter what you do, you will not improve. Like I have felt so often in my journey. So advancing, improving a little. And then Sherry, that's also fun to know. She's sharing, I am improving, but I wish I was also advancing faster. I stay on the same pieces to improve, but I get bored after a while with the same pieces. Yeah, that is a really fun thing, actually, to talk about. The feeling of being bored. I will come back to it in a second. Okay, yeah, very, very interesting. I'm seeing some other comments, people that feel like they are advancing, some people that say they are glad to participate. So happy you are here as well. And yeah, and Mariana feels like she's improving, which is great. And she is being really accurate. And yeah, I love what you're saying, Mariana. This is going to be one of the tips later on. So that makes complete sense. So yeah, feeling bored. Versus, let's see. Yeah, that's what I wanted to talk about. Bored versus feeling frustrated. I want you to type in the comments right now if you feel more bored or more frustrated. Which of the two emotions do you experience more often? And I will actually give you a personal evaluation after you've commented what probably your situation is right now. Because I see a common pattern in my students that if they feel bored, they have a certain problem. And if they feel frustrated, they have a certain problem. So I am going to check what all of you are saying. And I'm going to give you an evaluation based on, you know, what you probably need to do if you're bored and what you need to do if you feel more frustrated. So choose the one that feels most appealing to you, that you feel most like. Do you feel more like, oh my God, it's so boring what I'm practicing? Or, oh my God, I feel frustrated. I don't feel like I'm improving or, yeah, doing something really improving in a great way. So yeah, I see a lot of people saying frustrated and also quite some people saying bored, but most people actually frustrated. That's so interesting. Yeah, frustrated, I think not bored. I'm just starting to feel bored. So I find myself wandering off to do little things, says Josie. And Amaranath says, I feel like I can do nothing. Yeah, I definitely relate to that. Like, even though I've been playing for, I think, more than 15 years now, I sometimes feel like that as well. So I guess you will always feel like that if you play the violin. And Rick says, I'm never bored. Even that is the real, like, motivation, right? If you are like, no matter how much skills I do, I never get bored. That is what Rick says. Angela says, I think that's my problem. I don't feel like I'm improving. Yeah. Yeah, happy to feel like, to hear you kind of relate. So, I know that many people are actually in the trap of advancing, and it is definitely something you can get in really easily. So now, one of the first ways to improve is actually by the first thing we just did is checking if you're more bored or more frustrated, because that will probably tell you what to do. So if you feel mostly bored about your practice, probably you are actually improving. Most people that feel bored about their practice are often improving. It's not always the case, but probably you are practicing a lot of technique. You have been practicing your skills well. You have been one of these students that actually practices their skills if their teacher says they have to. And that is often the case with people that are bored. Of course, it's different for everybody, but that is what I often see the pattern. And if you feel frustrated, probably you have been practicing a lot of songs, but haven't worked on your fundamental techniques. So you have been spending more time on songs or things you can already do. So it's one of those two, either songs, or you have practiced stuff that you have practiced for a long time already. And you are practicing new songs every once in a while, but you are not really like fundamentally improving your technique because you haven't been doing as much technique exercises. So this is the first thing that probably if you feel frustrated, you need to challenge yourself by doing more like really fundamental technical exercises. Technical exercises where you are super, super precise about doing everything really, really well. And technique exercises that are actually going to make you move forward. This is the most common for people that are in the advancing stage, that they only learn new songs, they learn new random pieces. It is also very common for those that practice with YouTube only, by the way, because then you're like, oh, okay, watching another random video, and then you just move from random song to random video without any really proper structure. And what you need to do is to get a really proper structure and to actually think, okay, what is the next technique exercise that I need to implement in my playing right now? What is the next technique that like is slightly above the level? So maybe now you have only been practicing straight bow strokes, so just back and forth. And now you need to start to practice. You need to practice a different bow strokes, right? You want maybe to practice spiccato bow stroke. Oh, maybe spiccato bow stroke is even a little bit above your level, and you actually need to practice your martellet bow strokes that we've been practicing yesterday, by the way, where you are actually, you need to learn that. So it is different for everybody which technique that will be. And if you want my personal help with knowing which technique it will be, by the way, there's a great thing you can join. I will share more about it later. But the other group of people is the people that are bored. They are properly practicing a lot of technique exercises. Often you are improving actually if you feel bored, but of course you can get into the trap that you practice the same technique exercises all the time. So you do get bored, but you also don't really improve fundamentally. So that is definitely a trap you have to look out for, and to really make sure that if you practice your technique exercises, that you actually do challenge yourself to learn new things. And also to the second thing, all the other things that I am now sharing. So if you are practicing your technique exercises, if you do everything like you have a combination of songs and technique exercises, that is the perfect combination. If you do both, you both like fundamentally upgrade your skills. And at the same time, you also fundamentally like you learn new pieces and you really feel like you're learning new songs. That is, then you are at a great point. So that is the first thing to implement in your practice right now, to always practice both. Practice both challenging techniques and practice new pieces. And the best would be new pieces that integrate new techniques that feel difficult for you. So yeah, the next thing, so this is number two of advancing versus improving. If you want to improve, you need to listen. And probably you're saying right now, okay, I'm signing up, Julia. It's too obvious. Of course you need to listen to yourself. But First of all, I don't only mean listening to yourself. I also mean listening to others. So on the moment you want to learn a new piece, the first thing I recommend to do is not to start practicing right away, but to actually listen to the piece, how it is being played by other performers, and really paying attention to all the details. An improver, somebody that really improves their violin skills, is definitely mostly a perfectionist. Improving players are mostly people that are very, very precise about every single little detail. And that is definitely what I noticed, that my students that are from nature perfectionistic people often have a little head start when it comes to learning the violin, because it is just, for those people, it is very natural to be really perfectionistic, and they will fundamentally improve because they are never, ever happy with their results. That is, by the way, the downsides of being perfectionistic. Sometimes you can beat up yourself all the time, and it's also important to enjoy it. So that is a challenge for those people. But yeah, you need to listen to the piece and be really precise and listen really, really well. What is this performer doing? And then if you are playing the piece yourself, you need to play as closely to the version that you like most as you possibly can. So a big part of practicing is not only playing yourself, but also analyzing how other people are playing the pieces and trying to replicate that. After that, you need to listen really, really well to yourself, of course. And very often, I think people struggle more with it than they actually think. Like, I'm teaching now for how many years am I teaching? I think like 5 years I am doing this full time. And I notice very often with my students that they think they are listening to themselves, but actually they are not. Because actually they are worrying so much about if they are doing it in, if they are playing like in the right posture, if they have the bow, the right bow hold, what I will think about them when they are playing for me, like which notes they have to play next, if they are playing with or without sheet music. With sheet music, they sometimes only focus on the sheet music and don't even realize they are not paying attention to what they do anymore. So the first thing you need to do when you are practicing is listening. That comes before everything else. So I also mean that if you have to choose between messing up your bow hold and listening to yourself, choose for listening to yourself. And yeah, that can definitely be difficult for some people, because we are so, yeah, sometimes we want to do everything right, and then we forget the very core of what violin playing is, which is music, which is most important, is that we listen, right, if we play. But sometimes we miss this very basic thing that we think we all do, because we are so focused on all the little details and worry so much about everything except what it sounds like. And it's definitely interesting, and I notice it for myself too, that sometimes I have to take a step back and actually remember to listen. What does it actually sound like? Not what do I think it sounds like based on what I think I'm doing. Sometimes we get really rational. We think, oh, I'm holding the violin in the right place, putting the right fingers. I'm also holding the bow in the correct way. It should be sounding good. It is like what we are thinking without even like being conscious about it. So that is definitely something to look for. Another thing we need to do, if we are listening so well to ourselves and if we are really perfectionistic, so for those that are not natural perfectionists, try to imagine you are one and what you would tell about yourself. The next thing is to break things down, to really break it down in the smallest pieces you possibly can. So if you are listening really, really well to yourself, you notice at once that you cannot play one note properly. This is like really good listeners. Like, as long as we are maybe not the level of Hilary Hahn or somebody that's like perfect violin playing 100% of the time. And even those people make mistakes on stage. Like you, or they do things that maybe they don't enjoy about their playing as well. But let's assume we are not in that level. Probably you will always have something to criticize about every single note you play. Maybe that sounds a little stressful, right? And sometimes it is, and we need to take a step back and stop criticizing ourselves. but just enjoy the process. And we have to stop that voice inside of our head. But it is very important that if we want to become good at violin playing, we have to have this critical voice. And this is a part, like always listening. And for each note you play, there will be something you can improve. Then you need to find out, you cannot improve everything at the same time. So what are the most important things to improve? And this can actually, a teacher can help you with it. Like in my academy, I'm giving my students feedback and I tell them what is the most important thing to improve. I'm not like bashing every single thing they do because it doesn't make sense. As a teacher, I'm not saying like, oh, you do that wrong, that, because everybody will completely get overwhelmed and frustrated. So you have to take maybe one, two, or three things out that you think are the most important things to improve. And then you work on those really, really focused in small chunks. So that can mean only working on one bar for an entire practice session of 30 minutes. So then you're just working on perfecting that one bar or that one note to make sure it sounds in tune. And that asks a lot of concentration. And if we practice like this, often we can't practice more than 7 minutes because we are so tired. And actually, the amount of time that an average adult can focus is 7 minutes, according to science. So just imagine, like, if we really, really focus that well, it is really difficult to practice. And we might have to practice for shorter amounts of time, but with more focus. So yeah, I see some people say like, oh my God, I feel like you're watching my practice sessions. I'm so critical of myself. And by the way, Marlene is saying she is critical of herself. And I think Marlene, for all that know Marlene from Julia's Violin Academy, now see that this is the perfect example of somebody that is critical and making a lot of progress, because Marlene started only a few years ago, I think when she was 45, and she has made so much progress that some of my children's students didn't see. So actually, this is the perfect example of what can happen if you are this critical of yourself. So yeah, so now let's move to the next thing. If we are this critical of ourselves and break things down, right? So we have a piece and we only practice the little things. That is what you need to do, right? Okay, very important. One other thing, don't perform when you are practicing. What do I mean with not performing when you're practicing? What I call a performance is when you play the complete piece through from the beginning till the end. That's a performance, right? But so many of us confuse performing with practicing. Practicing with performing, actually. Instead of practicing, which means taking three bars out and only practicing these three bars and perfecting them, perfecting little parts of the piece, we are just playing a run through. We are playing the complete piece. This is what we do when we perform. And of course, it has its benefits if we want to perform to do it sometimes. It also has its benefits to do this for fun. We want to have fun, but you need to separate your fun time, playthrough time, from your practice time. And you need to realize that this is not the same thing. If you are just playing through a piece, that cannot be seen as practice. In serious practice, you take only a few parts out and only practice these. That is serious practice. Run through or performing, also if it is just for yourself, is not to be counted as practice. This is performing and this is something else. So really important, only take parts out that are hard, only focus on your weaknesses. And this is difficult and this takes a lot of concentration, and this means you can maybe only practice for 7 minutes and then you can perform and play through and have your fun time. But do this at least for 7 minutes and you will see a difference if you start doing this. Another thing is to be really, really slow. So on the moment you are practicing, this is another thing. This is all what improvers do. They are slow. They are not playing only run-throughs. They are practicing. They are serious practice. They break things down. They listen to themselves. And they are slow. When they make a mistake, they try to play so slowly that they won't make the mistake. So instead of making the mistake again and again, they will actually practice to not make the mistake, because this is basically what you're doing. If you're playing things through really, really quickly and making a mistake, you are basically practicing your mistakes, right? You are practicing what you are playing, because the more often you play something, the more it will get into your fingers, the more it will get into your bowing. So you will play it that exact way in the future as well. So we need to practice it the way we want to play it in the end. So that means we really need to slow down so we can hit every single note perfectly. This is what a real improver does. So I'm so happy that so many of you are still here, because I love it. It is not very easy to talk about things like that. You know, sometimes it's more fun to practice the skills, but I love how everybody is paying so much attention, because I feel like we can practice so much skills, and I could do little exercises every day with you. But if you don't integrate this into your practice, this is like so fundamental and such a core thing that I think this is way more important than practicing one skill, you know, because if you're doing it in the right way, if you're practicing every day in the right way, that is like so much more important than practicing random things all the time. Practicing right will make a difference. So now we come to another part of being an improver. An improver is setting goals. A real improver is not practicing randomly, like, oh, whatever, I like to play that piece, I will play it now. Oh, now I play that piece. That is an advancer. That person is just going from video to video, to piece to piece. It is also the typical YouTube algorithm. You know what YouTube algorithm is like, right? It is just like, you watch this video, oh, maybe that video would be fun. Oh, maybe that video would be fun. That is what YouTube works like. YouTube is definitely an advancer and not an improver if YouTube would be able to play the violin. So you need to be not like YouTube. You need to be focused. Like, for instance, this classroom. This classroom has just one video, and you only watch this video. And if you go away from this video, you are only focused on one thing. And that is what you need to do as an improver. You need to choose one thing to focus on. And maybe if you're, for instance, in the beginner course in the academy, that will be only practicing slurs exercises. For instance, that is what we do in the beginner course, right? We only practice slurs. First, we only practice slurs on one string. Then we only practice slurs crossing strings. Then we integrate detached note into our slurs. So we take it one step at a time, and each time we make it a little bit more difficult, but we really focus in on one aspect. And only after you've mastered one aspect, go to the next aspect. And this is definitely really, really important. And I think I would say, like, why I'm so passionate about this specific thing that we are talking about today, advancing versus improving and how to become an improver, is because this is like the fundamental difference between my students that are most successful and those that get frustrated and give up. The ones that are most successful and really start really enjoying playing are always, like, mostly they are the improvers. And I also noticed that this is nothing about age. I have seen people that are improvers that are like starting 60 years old, and I've seen improvers that start at 10 years old, but there's advancers and improvers in any age category. And definitely you can become an improver no matter what age you are, and you will always have the benefit over the advancer, even if you actually feel like you started too old or something like that, right? So yeah, so that are really important things. So let's break it down again. You need to listen really, really well to yourself. You need to break things down. You need to never do any run-throughs when you practice, but only practice the pieces that are important. You have to practice really, really slowly, and you have to set goals for yourself. Now, it's not always easy to set a goal for yourself because, you know, for instance, I set the goals for my students. I tell them what to practice next. And for instance, the method that I'm using, I take like full days to only think about what my students should practice next. And literally, I work on this every single day. And many of you do have jobs. You are actually like, you don't have a full day to think about what to practice next, right? This is like taking me so much time as a teacher. So I can't even imagine. It can be really difficult to set a goal. So it might be helpful to get the help of a teacher that will actually tell you what to do next, because, you know, it might actually save you so, so much time. So yeah, I really, really hope these principles, you are going to apply them in your lessons. And if you would like the help of a teacher, definitely be sure to get me as a teacher, because I would love to help you. So if you feel like, whoa, I want to become an improver, please tell me what to practice. I will do everything you say. That are my favorite students, by the way. Do everything I say. No, don't worry. Actually, my favorite students are you, because you are here right now and you take the time to come to the class. So I really, really love people that take the time to do the classes instead of watching cat videos, going to Netflix or something like that. So yeah, that brings me to a really exciting announcement. And that is that I will take a new group of students in Julia's Violin Academy starting May 18th. So there will actually be a new group of students and I will personally tell them what to practice, what to do. So yeah, many of you are already students at Julia's Violin Academy, so you can know how nice and positive place it is. It is not just me, it is also just a really amazing group of students that is all supporting each other. But in May, I'm taking a new class of students. And if you are not a part of it yet, and maybe you feel like this is something you would like to do, if you maybe don't, that was my table. If you don't really have the money for really expensive private lessons, but would like to practice with a lot of structure, a lot of support, and really know what to practice next, and never like being confused and being like clicking from video to video and not knowing what to do next. If you get frustrated with that and really want somebody to help you, this is something you will really, really enjoy and definitely look into it. But maybe I can show you, like, if you are interested to join our May class, I think the best way to show is actually to show you the academy from the inside, because it is always hard, especially with online learning, to get an idea of what it really looks like if you didn't see it. And by the way, for those that are here and want to join, I have a special surprise, because, you know, I love students that are really, really active. I notice it, like those that come to live classes, that is like that makes the academy come alive. I love that. And we really need more students that come to classes like you. So if you want to join, and if you join tonight after this class, 1 hour after the class ended, so that would be like from now on, 1 hour after, I will send you my favorite book for etude book, which is worth $20 alone. And that will an etude book with for beginners that I think is the best etude book to get started with if you want to get into really getting technical, improving your skills. So now I will show you the academy from the inside. And you can definitely also ask questions in the chat, because there's quite some members right now in the chat that will probably be really happy to help you with any questions as well, because they know it the best. Like, I'm the teacher, but I don't really, like, as a student, the experience is always different, but I can tell you the students are super, super nice in the academy. That is what I know as a teacher. So I am really lucky, I guess, with everybody that is here right now. So I'm going to show it to you. I should be able to share my screen to show the academy. Let's see how it works. Bear with me, I'm not like the most technical fast person sometimes, but it will work out. Yes, okay, here's the academy. Okay, can everybody see the academy now? I'm actually logged into Sasha's account right now. So yeah, you should be able to see it right now. So this is the inside of the academy. Oh, what is that? That's normally not happening. So yeah, here you can see the inside. First of all, we have a really, really structured learning system in the academy. So that is really helping you to actually learn with a lot of structure. So not just learn with random YouTube videos, but actually go from exercise to exercise that are actually progressive. So that are not just random exercises all the time, but, you know, when you've learned level one, you've learned specific bone techniques of level one, you can move to level two and learn the bone techniques of level two. So it is progressive and always like goes from level to level. So for instance, here you can see beginner level one, that is the first level after the basics course. The basics course is for people that just got started playing the violin, that literally have no idea what they are doing, they need to learn how to hold the violin. The beginner course is for those that want to start fundamentally improving. And you will get a course book for each level. So each course is divided in level. You have the beginner course, and then if you finish the beginner course, you will move on to the improver course. So actually the class that started in November, which was the last class that officially got started, they are mostly, most people of the last class are now in the improver course. So here you can see like one level, you will learn specific skills in each level, then you will get a workbook that belongs to a level that will show you all the exercises and motivating snails that will help you to keep going, because I don't know why, actually, I just really like snails. So I guess that's not a very good reason. So so you move up to beginner level 5. After you've finished beginner level 5, you go to improver. Now I can show you, for instance, if you click on one exercise, you will always have, first you have the explanation. So this is just one exercise of the academy. First I explain it, and then you have the play alongs over here. So you can first play along in slow speed, and then in medium speed, and then in fast speed. And if you have learned it in all play along speed, you can move on to the next lesson. And then below here, you actually can see watch other practice, and then you can see other people that are practicing the same exercise and see like what I advise them to do differently, which brings me to the feedback section of the academy. This is the feedback section, and this is where you can submit your own practice videos, and I will give a personal reply. So here you can submit a video if you click this button over here, and like here you can submit a video to me. And if you've submitted the video, you can actually click your video. I will upload a reply to your video and tell you what you need to practice. So over here, you can see an example of me giving a reply to somebody. I'm not going to show the video, but this will give you an idea. And then we have live events. I think I really, really love the live events. I think they are like the core of our academy, and that really makes us into a really nice group, because some things you can't show it in the tab, and that is the amazing group of students we have. Like, I'm really, really thankful myself, because this is not something I could have created, but we have such a supportive group of people, and they are all adult beginners. That is like the main group of people that is learning. And I really love how I got to know people from all over the world. And I think other people can tell as well that it is just so nice. We all meet, like every day we have live events where we practice together. Here you can see the event that is going on right now. But we have practice prints and events every single day, actually. Here you can see, if I go to the month, and we have them in different time zones. We have a lot of volunteers in the academy that are hosting practice events as well. It's really hard to explain what it is like to join an event if you didn't do it, but it is like a Skype room, and you are all seeing each other. You can see how many events we host. It's a lot. And we really need more people to join it. It would be really awesome to get to know more people. I really, really like this as one of the most, like the thing I like most about the academy, because I got to know so many new people, and I feel like so many feel the same. It's really supportive to get to know other people that are having the same struggles as you, and that you actually realize like, oh, wait a second, everybody finds this really difficult. I'm not the only one that is like not improving at violin playing and feeling like, you know, that is what we can feel like sometimes if we watch YouTube videos, and then you see all those people like, my violin progress, after 1 year I could already play Vivaldi. Then you start to feel like maybe something is off with you, but now you can actually see other people just like you that are maybe also just having a job and don't have full-time time to practice, and what their progress looks like, and to support each other. So that is really, really fun. And here you can see what the Skype room looks like when we are talking with each other and practicing together. So it's a little bit different. In this specific day, there were a lot of people. Sometimes it's very small. Sometimes there's not a lot of people. And we are just with a small group of just 3 people or something like that. So yeah, it really depends on the day. So yeah, that gives a little idea of what it looks like. And then we also have the community. The resources section, by the way, is a section where you can find all the recordings of live events, but also, yeah, all the extras. Like there's like, we have one member, he's actually a computer programmer. So he actually created a plugin for us to to check if we are playing in tune. It's really, really nice. Like, we have members contributing to the academy as well in this way. So here you can see our Facebook group. We also have a Facebook community. You don't have to join that, but it is really nice to join. And we are sharing really awesome things there together. For instance, each Monday, we are sharing our practice plan. So we share with each other what we practiced this week to hold each other accountable. And then each Tuesday, we are like, I am asking some interesting questions so we can get to know each other better. Like, maybe who would you prefer to be, Mozart or Lizzie Sterling? And then we have nice discussions about that. And Wednesday, we have the Stage Is Yours post. This is where we share pieces that we are currently working on. And yeah, we have a lot of posts. It is, that just motivate us to do something of violin playing every day. I think I also like the Thursday post, which is the Small Steps post, which will tell you about, the small steps you need to take. Like every week we have taken small steps, and then we are sharing them with each other, what we have done this week to practice. And that can be something really small, like putting our bow in the right place. And here you can see our community. It's actually a really active community that is really, like, it's very nice to post something there. I just, really nice people that will support you to learn in a really, really nice way. So now I'm coming back to, Let's see how I can come back from the screen share. Okay, you should be able to see me again. So if you would like to join our May class, definitely sign up. You can sign up at Julia's, wait a second, I will have to post the link, otherwise nobody will know how to sign up, right? So I will post the link right now. And that is where you can sign up. And you might be wondering, I realized I forgot to share, what is my investment in this class? And it will be $39, which converts to about 34.5 euros a month or something like that. Right now, it always changes a little bit, the dollar to euro conversion. Right now, I want to share the link with you. So, right now, I see the link is there. Okay, so that is where you can actually enroll to the May class. And what is really nice about the May class, if you enroll and you start to join our May class, we will actually meet up with the new students privately with me. So everybody that is new to the academy will meet with me, and we will go together over where you are right now, what your goals are with the academy. And we are meeting up every week in the first few weeks that you are a member. And I'm going to personally help you to actually create a practice plan for you, so you know where to start, because I know it can be a little bit overwhelming if you're getting started. And so the first session we meet up and we check where we are and what our goals are, what we would like to achieve. Then in the second session, I will help you to create a practice plan for yourself, and what you will practice in the next week. And then we will do evaluation session where we share with each other how it has been so far, how practice has been going. And I will also help you if you have still some struggles with practicing with that. So it's really nice to both get to know the new group of students, so you are not like joining on your own, but you're with this really amazing group that will all join with you. And then you also have my personal support to help you. So the etude book will also be available for those that are already in the academy. If you have joined this class, you will also get it. So just write me an email in that case, and I would love to give you the book as well. So if you join tonight, you will get the etude book as a little extra. And if you want to join our course in general, the enrollment window is until Friday next week, because Saturday will be our first live call with everybody that has joined the May group. So definitely be sure to join if you are excited to get the help of me and also a whole group of other people that is really excited to help you. And if you are an academy member and if you know people that might be interested in joining the May class, definitely share the word. Would be really, really nice to get to know new people. And to make the academy open for new people. I'm really excited about this, because last time we opened was November 2016 that we had this big opening. So yeah, I really look forward to get to know new people. That will be really, really nice. And now, if you have any questions about this, definitely feel free to ask, because right now I'm available for questions. So if you still have any questions about the Academy, what it works like, how you can join, I don't know. Any questions you might have, you can ask them right now. So feel free to write them in the chat. I see, danke. Thank you. And I'm also so happy to see that Mary is back. I see Mary in the chat. That's so awesome. Mary has been a member of the Academy, but she has been gone for a while. So that's great. And she's, yeah. So if you have any questions, write them in the chat right now. And yeah, also write us an email if you have any more questions about the Academy. You can always write julia@violinspiration.com and I will answer all your questions. Do you have to pay month to month or for the year? No, it's month to month and you can cancel every month. Most members don't cancel because they really like it. But yeah, so you just pay for 1 month, each month. You can cancel anytime. It's really, really easy. It's just, you just go to your profile and click cancel and you already canceled. There's no fancy cancellation stuff you need to do or something like that. Yeah, so that is really nice. I think about your Academy as well, knowing about some software you use and how hard it can be to cancel sometimes. So yeah, the existing members get the Etude book. You can just write me an email. If you have been in this class, you can always write as well. So Marlene says she has 48 hours a day. Yeah, but there's it's not only me. It is also other people that are helping with the Academy. Oh, yeah. Sorry about that, Marlene, that I canceled your account. That was a mistake. But I'm happy you're back. How much is it each month? So it is $39 a month. So that is really, really low price. This is definitely because we are really new. We started in November. So we are just like trying to spread the word and getting to know more people that are interested in this. So yeah, definitely take your chance, because normally one private lesson with me would cost more than that. And I'm definitely putting a lot of time in every member. So yeah, definitely worth this value, I believe. I would love to have joined an Academy like this, I have to say. So what time do you normally do live events? That's a really good question. So most live events are either at, there's actually different time zones, but most live events where that are most popular, like that are mostly like the events where I host specific like practice challenges or what else, that is mostly in either in the evening in Europe. So this time, like a little bit before this time, actually, like normally like 3 hours before now, that's a regular time for our live events. And then you also have the American time zone events. That is in the evening in the States. So this is the evening in Europe. And I think most of our members are able to join. We have live events also at 12 o'clock in Europe. I'm not sure what it will convert to in other regions of the world. So in Europe, 12 o'clock, 7 o'clock at night, and then 2 o'clock in the night, which will convert to 5 PDT. So Pacific Daylight Time will be 5 o'clock. And yeah, there's also some younger students. I see there's somebody that is 14 years old. And actually, yeah, you wouldn't be the younger student. There are some people that are younger. It is definitely like, you are definitely a little bit older already. So I think you can definitely join, because you need to have you also your own motivation to come and log in and join the event. But I definitely think like if you have like intrinsic motivation, which I think you do have, knowing that you came to this event by yourself without even having to, that is definitely a sign that it is the right thing for you. I know for some, there has been like one kid or no, I think two kids in the past that were there and they canceled because they just never came and never logged in. So yeah, you do have to have your own motivation. But if you come and join us, you will definitely benefit from it. It can have a very nice like playing effect as well, to have the levels. Like some people that are younger actually like that. I know I like it very much, but that you actually have like the levels that you have to complete, which actually works really well, I believe, for all ages. Yeah, so definitely welcome as well if you're younger. and some of the most eager joint pricks. That is definitely true. We host live events in the academy, and some people actually join in midnight. They will just wake up to come and practice with us. And I'm like, I am like the only, like, I know a lot of violin teachers, and my friends are very often like, yeah, my students, they don't practice. And I'm like, my students wake up in the middle of the night to practice, and they are like so jealous of me. But I think I'm lucky. But it's also great to have such a motivated group. Yeah, there's some younger people in the violin group. I think the youngest is 6 right now. Yeah, but I think you know her. Don't you know Sarja? She is really, really motivated, and she's very young. So yeah. Yeah, so yeah, really nice to see all of your supportive comments, by the way, from all the members. Yeah, thank you so much. I'm really glad to say that you see that you are having a good time at the Academy, and that's really important to me as well. So yeah, I think that really speaks for the Academy a lot. Like, in my opinion, like, the best thing I can offer anybody is just really, really caring about the students. And I think I really do. Like, I do really care that my students improve. And yeah, I think that is the most important thing to give as a teacher. It is not to be the best player of the world, or to be like always like being super strict or whatever, but really, really caring about the students and really like caring about their improvement. And I putting that before everything else, that they are having a good time and that they improve, is really important to me. And not, for instance, that I become the most famous, most fancy violin player or something like that. Yeah, actually, I did have those teachers. Not to bash any teachers, but some teachers find it more important to have, like, to play in an orchestra or something like that. So I think that is the most valuable things I have to offer, to really put all my time in my students and all my energy. So, yeah. So, oh, I'm really excited to hear that the Huckleberry Boys is actually signing up. I don't know what your name is. Yeah, I'm definitely giving a shout out to everybody who does sign up tomorrow, probably. Huckleberry Boys, I don't know what your name is. So, yeah, if there's any other questions, let me know. And Bob says, I'm never going to cancel my membership. Oh, Nate is your name. Oh, so nice to have you join, Nate. Nice. And definitely post in the Facebook group and say hi to all of us. I would really like to see you. And yeah, so that's it for tonight. We will have another session tomorrow where I share another practice hack. So I hope this was really interesting for you as well, the things we talked about, like the practice we did today, and that you are going to implement all of this in your practice routine, all the hacks that we have been talking about, and that you are really going to be an improver after today. And if you want to be an improver and have help with being an improver, definitely also join us. So I will post a link once more, juliasviolinacademy.com, and join our May class. And I look forward to get to know you, and also see you tomorrow for the next practice hack. Thank you so much for being there tonight, and see you later, everybody. See you very soon.